concept on an election. So the objective for the election, pretty much I'll talk about the pathophysiology of anaphylaxis, some sort of criteria, you know, for the diagnosis and treatment. So this schematic up here is kind of like showing like a bump and, you know, going through the pathophysiology of anaphylaxis. And when we talk about anaphylaxis, there's actually two kind of like different mechanisms. So this type of pathway, or where somebody had some sort of previous exposure to something, and then when they are re-exposed again, you know, then they develop anaphylaxis. That's the classic, you know, pathway, or the classic anaphylaxis. There's a second type, you know, where you don't actually have to have a previous exposure, just the first attempt, and then, you know, and that's, you know, typically referred to as anaphylactoid or reaction. So in the classical pathway, you get exposed to something the first time around, you know, something like a bee bite or sting, and then you get sensitized, you know, your IgEs are pretty much, you know, are sensitized at that time, and then you make antibodies, you know, that will later on you recognize the same antigen if you were to be exposed to it again. So in this schematic, for example, so this would be a second exposure to this same antigen. So the antigen comes, pretty much the IgE that were pre-sensitized before recognizes that antigen, they cross links, you know, and then they stimulate your histamines, you know, and basophils. So this causes a massive release of histamine and some other mediators, and then you can see kind of like how the symptom that you see in anaphylaxis happens. So in the lung, for example, histamine goes there, causes you to wheeze, you know, you get bronchospasm and vasoconstriction. So the person is having trouble breathing. It goes into your heart as well, you know, causes vasodilation, kind of like the same thing. You get decreased output, decreased coronary flow. The same thing in the blood vessels, you know, because they get so dilated, the capillaries are not touching, and then you get food leaking out of the capillaries, and then, you know, you get edema. Because histamine, you know, causes itching, you get itching, and you can get on urticaria and edema. And that's kind of like the classic pathway right there. So since we talk about some sort of criteria, so there's really no criteria to diagnose anaphylaxis because it's a clinical diagnosis. But some people say you have to have, you know, some sort of guide as to when do we call it anaphylaxis versus just, you know, hypersensitivity or reaction. Because it's like a spectrum. You can have just, you know, urticaria by itself, and that wouldn't qualify as anaphylaxis, except, you know, they have something else. So if you know, and this is kind of like a schematic, if you know somebody has a known or unknown allergen exposure, and all of a sudden they just have urticaria and angioedema, if they have at least one of the other, you know, symptoms, like respiratory symptoms, or if their blood pressure is low, if they syncopize and those kind of things, then that qualifies as anaphylaxis. If you think there's a likely allergen exposure and they have two of those, you know, either skin symptoms or respiratory, or any of those, then, you know, that also qualifies as anaphylaxis. If you know this person have a non-allergen exposure, if they told you, for example, this has happened to me before, and they come in, maybe a little rash and low blood pressure, you know, that automatically qualifies, you know, for anaphylaxis. This slide is kind of like loaded, but what I just want you to see out of it is just a picture, especially the 1, 2, 3, 4, the number 4 one. So as is, you know, with everything in emergency medicine, if anyone comes in, your first thing is ABC, IV02 monitor. While you're doing that as well, if you think somebody has anaphylaxis, especially if, you know, if they happen to be hypotensive, you want to keep their, you know, feet elevated, you know, on the bed, you know, because that increases on venous return to the heart, and that kind of like help, you know, with the pressure as well. So I mentioned some of it earlier, like how do you diagnose anaphylaxis? It's a clinical diagnosis, so there is really no blood test or imaging, you know, that you need, you know, to help you. But sometimes in order to rule out, you know, differential diagnosis, you know, especially if you maybe EMIM or just IM people, you probably, you know, you may consider some labs, you know, just to confirm or, you know, rule out other things. And one of the things that you may want to get, although it's not widely available, is the plasma histamine level. And histamine level lasts about, or histamine itself, you know, lasts in the blood for about 30 minutes. So you can imagine by the time the person has this reaction and get to the ED, histamine is already cleared, you know, from your blood. So histamine may not help you in that, you know, case. Tryptase is a longer lasting, you know, peptide in the body. And whenever histamine, you know, mast cell, you know, degranulates, they also release on tryptase, and tryptase can last for hours. So if you really want to make sure this is anaphylaxis, you can send a tryptase level, which will be elevated, you know, at that point. Or you can get a urinary histamine metabolite, and that will also, you know, help you if you really want to confirm. Or it can help you to also rule out mastocytosis, which kind of like presents like anaphylaxis. So the difference in mastocytosis is the person always have elevated urinary histamine, versus in anaphylaxis. Only at that particular episode, would the histamine, urinary histamine level be elevated, because your mast cells are not degranulating all the time, so they only do it while you have an acute episode, so it will be elevated at that time, but at baseline it will be normal. But again, none of these tests is really needed, you know. So the other thing that also presents, you know, kind of like anaphylaxis is carcinoid syndrome, where you get this wheezing, you may have mono, you know, because it destroys your tricuspid valve, and you may get edema, you may even get rash, you know, because of over secretion of mediators. So for that, you can do what they call, you know, 5-hydroxyindoleacetic acid, and that will kind of like help you confirm a carcinoid syndrome. So now, if you're thinking, you know, anaphylaxis, you should kind of like, you know, stop right there and then, you know, quickly jump into action rather than thinking, you know, what to rule out or how to, because, you know, this is not a time to get HDI. This is kind of like a time to treat, because this can be quickly fatal. So again, the treatment, pretty much, you know, ABC, IV, O2 monitor. And then, you know, I'll kind of like go through, you know, some of these a little bit. So if they come in and you're already thinking anaphylaxis, you know, the most important thing is to make sure that the airway is patent. So anaphylaxis, again, is on the spectrum. You know, the extreme end is when the patient comes and they don't have an airway, you know, where you may have to intubate them right away. And sometimes it may be difficult, you know, because of the edema in the airway, you may not actually be able to pass a tube. And your other go-to would be, you know, to cry the patient, you know, just to keep the airway open. You want to get in the breathing, circulation, and all that stuff. You know, you'd be hypotensive, you know, you need to give fluids. But the first thing after you already secure the airway is to give epinephrine. That's what has been shown to actually, you know, help so the anaphylaxis doesn't progress, you know, to like the severe, you know, form. So, and where do you want to give the epi? Pretty much in the anterior media aspect of the thigh, and that's where you should, you know, give it. Some people are giving it in the deltoid area, but that doesn't, you know, it's not as effective as giving it in the anterior media thigh. You want to have them on the monitor, you know, because you want to see the rhythm. And then again, epi can also, you know, causes arrhythmia, you know, it raises your heart rate and all that stuff. So you really want to see what's going on. And they should be on oxygen as well, because, you know, this is an airway issue. So any amount of oxygen, you know, will actually help. So we already talked about epi as being the first line treatment. There are other medicines, you know, that you have to give, you know, but they kind of like considered, you know, second line treatment. And one of them is our H2 blockers. And you know, histamine has at least, you know, two receptors, histamine 1 and histamine 2. So sometimes, you know, if you give antihistamine like, you know, diphenhydramine, for example, histamine can still bind, you know, to H2, and it can, you know, exert some of the mechanism like that. So you need to block, you know, both histamine receptors. Steroids. The steroids, you know, are not going to help you right away. There are some mediators called delayed phase reactant that comes in like 4 to 6 hours after the initial episode. So while the epi buys you time, you know, like right away, if you don't do anything else, 6 hours later or 4 hours later, or by the time you discharge the patient, they'll have a second episode, which will actually be worse than the initial one. So that's where the steroid comes in, you know, to work on the delayed phase reactant. And, you know, they may or may not require pressors. I've actually never seen, you know, an episode of anaphylaxis myself, but I remember while talking to Paul, you know, writing these slides, he kind of like talked about a patient that they had in the ICU, that they had to give up to 4 different pressures, you know, before they can even get any response in blood pressure. So it is kind of like real. Anaphylaxis can be pretty, you know, bad. Like, you know, you throw in fluid, throw in all this stuff, and nothing is happening. You know, FPE, all kind of pressures, you know, before you get anything. So it is real, and it's something you have to kind of like look out for. And when someone like this comes, you know, you really, I mean, you're not gonna have a lot of time, so you want to do something like RSI, and you know, just be careful of your medication options, you know, because if this is somebody that's already hypotensive, you don't want to be like using medication that even make that worse, like you know, benzodiazepines and stuff like that. And that's pretty much all that I have about anaphylaxis, and those are my reactions.